Hello, chess fans. Welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I am George Merejanian, Program Director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday evening from 7 to 11 in room C-159 in the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Production Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted in the control room by our audio technician, Rob Barbarian of Templeton. And behind the camera is our longtime Wachusett Chess Club member and FATV volunteer, Brian Bigelow of Fitchburg. And across from me is my trusty co-host, dedicated associate, chess author, our own Dave Kuchar of Westminster. Hello, Dave.
Good
to
see
you.
Good to see you.
Well, Dave, today is a special program of Chess Chat, because we're going to be paying tribute to Bobby Fischer. Now, Bobby Fischer was the first and only American to win the World Chess Championship. Yeah. What year did he do this? When did he become world champion?
1972.
And where did he do this?
Reykjavik, Iceland.
And whom did he play?
Boris Spassky.
All right, so, and this is ingrained in you. Anyone who's serious about chess knows about Boris Fischer beating Boris Spassky in Reykjavik, Iceland. That got news, not only nationally, coast to coast, but worldwide. That got more chess coverage, I mean than any other chess
regular,
event.
Regular news coverage.
Regular news coverage, that was really good. Well, you know, Bobby Fischer, again, we're doing a 75th anniversary tribute because Bobby would have turned 75 years old this past Friday, March 9th, 2018, but he died 10 years ago.
Has it really been 10 years?
It's been 10 years. Bobby.
I was going to say it was a couple of years
ago. No, it was actually
Seriously?
10 years ago. No, it was January of 2008 in Reykjavik, Iceland. A tragedy, really a tragic story.
Yeah.
And we'll be able to talk about Bobby here. Actually, before we show any video or photos, let's actually tell our viewers what they're going to see.
Okay.
What we have are some vintage TV clips from shows where Bobby appeared. One of his early appearances on television was on the I've Got a Secret show, I've Got a Secret, hosted by Gary Moore. This was done in 1958, March, I think, of 1958. Bobby Fischer, in January of 1958, became the U.S. chess champion. He was 14 years old when he did it.
The youngest ever.
The youngest ever, right, exactly. So we have he was on I've Got a Secret. You're going to see Dick Clark. Remember Dick Clark from American Bandstand?
Yeah.
He was one of the panelists on I've Got a Secret. They couldn't figure out who Bobby was, you know. But let's actually have Darren, our director, show this clip from 1958, Bobby Fischer on the I've Got a Secret show.
Again, we're going to call this young gentleman Mr. X. Will you tell us how old you are and where you're from?
I'm 15, I'm from Brooklyn.
He is 15 years old and he is from Brooklyn. All right? Will you show your headline to camera 3 and to Dick Clark, because we'll make him go to work on you. It says, teenager's strategy defeats all comers.
This strategy, did it involve finances?
No.
Did you have any help?
No.
Did it all by yourself? Did it make people happy?
Made me happy, sir.
That's a good start. Good start. Did what you do have its effect indoors?
Yes.
All right, Dick, we've gone down the drain. This young man's name is Bobby Fischer. He is 15 years old. And listen to this. Already, he is the United States chess champion. And I don't mean I don't mean teenage champion, youngsters champion. He has defeated the Masters. He is the top ranking of the United States champion in chess. And I just think it's fantastic. How long have you been playing?
I learned it when I was six.
Wow.
When you were six. But you've been playing seriously only since when? The last...
Nine. It's about nine.
From nine on. Now come the pink cards. Because this is a surprise to everybody, including Bobby. All of us have been reading about you, Bobby, of course. Especially about your invitation to go to Russia and to Yugoslavia to compete against the greatest chess champions from all over the world in the international tournament this summer. Isn't that right?
That's right.
Now, the only thing that has been keeping this young man from accepting this invitation to the international tournament is the lack of money for transportation. And that's understandable. I think it would be a shame, we think it would be a shame, for an American to have to lose by default. So here for you, Bobby, are two round-trip tickets for you and your older sister to accompany you aboard Sabena Airlines to Moscow. Here's the Sabena Airlines handbag for you to carry your chess men in or whatever you care to carry in it. And I want to thank Sabena, by the way, for their marvelous cooperation and the last-minute arrangements for this young man. Good luck to you, Bobby. We'll be rooting for you over there in Yugoslavia and in Russia, and we hope that when you come back... We hope you will come back a champion, but whether you do or not, I hope that you'll drop back in on I've Got a Secret again and tell us about your adventures. Will you do that?
So that was Bobby Fischer on the I've Got a Secret show from 1958, March of 1958. He had won the U.S. championship 2 months earlier, January of that year. And he you know what he scored in that U.S. championship? He scored 10.5 points out of 13. It was a four. Okay. It was actually a double round. It was 14 players. No, a single round robin.
Okay.
14 players. So he played 13 games. He scored 10.5 points out of a possible 30. He was the only undefeated player in that championship. By the way, that was the first of 8 U.S. championships that he won.
Right.
So that's so he had he racked up a lot of U.S. championship wins.
And so he won every championship he competed in, every U.S. championship.
Yes, exactly.
And he won every one by at least a full point.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. He was definitely dominated chess.
Yeah.
Back in the late 50s through the, I think his last U.S. championship win was the 1966-67 one. Yeah. So anyways, now we're going to go to another interesting clip that was done 1 year before Fischer won the world championship.
Okay.
It was done, in the summer of 1971 when Dick Cavett interviewed him. He actually interviewed him twice. He interviewed him the following year when he won the championship. But in 1971, he had Bobby on. And what can I say about this? This is a highly interesting clip with Bobby on this show. So let's show this clip from the Dick Cavett Show. By the way, the Dick Cavett Show, you can watch reruns now on the cable access. Mm-hmm. I think it's on the channel that shows the Decade. Maybe it's the Decades channel, whatever it's called. I watch Dick Cavett reruns. But anyways, this is a rerun that they haven't shown yet.
Okay.
But let's show it here on FATV. Dick Cavett, Bobby Fischer.
And so forth. Where do you live now, Bob? Where does a chess player live?
I don't live anywhere, actually. Just live in hotels.
You don't have permanent. You follow chess the
right,
way surfers
yeah.
follow the sun. And what's the money in chess?
The money, could be better. It's getting better, but yeah, it's not like what you're getting or something.
It may be. You haven't seen my contract. Why is it that the Russians dominate the chess world? What have they got?
Well, it's subsidized by the government, and all their players are professionals, so they keep at it. We have a lot of talented players in this country, but for one reason or another, they just kind of fade out. They lose interest because there's not that much incentive.
Yeah. And you've made some rather strong charges against them a couple of times involving...
Cheating.
Cheating, I think, is the word that I was looking for. Yeah. What was the evidence of that?
Well, they came. One tournament I played in back in '62, that was a specific one I was talking about. They prearranged about a dozen games among themselves to eliminate me.
How did they prearrange it? I mean, they had the strategy worked out among each other.
Right. Yeah.
That isn't illegal, though, is it? Is that conspiracy?
No, it's against the rules. But.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's what I meant. Against the rules. Yeah. So that would be the kind of cheating you mean.
Oh, well, also sometimes they would discuss the game among themselves while it's in progress. He'd advise each other. And, you know, little things like that. Yeah. I complained a lot about it back then.
Have you changed? You know, all the press about you has talked about your cantankerous period where you would go stomping out and say, I cannot work under these lights and so forth. And then after the period where you were away, you came back milder.
Yeah, you could say that.
Is there any, there have been all kinds of rumors, like there's a certain woman who changed. Someone gave him a pill. I don't know what the others are. Those are two of them.
I just sort of handle journalists a little better, you know. Handle myself with people a little better. I haven't changed that much.
You haven't changed that much? You
no.
Just know how to handle the press now.
Right, right.
Is chess a gift? Could a guy who doesn't have a gift for it learn to be a great chess player?
Great? No, he could be good, though. A lot of top players, I don't think, are that talented. They just work like dogs, you know.
Is it inherited, or do you come from chess players?
No. I mean, my mind isn't heard of it, no.
And what is it, what goes with a great chess ability? Are you terrifically logical in your thought processes? Can you see where an argument is going? Are you very neat in your personal life, in your room? Do you leave your ties on the floor? Any of the above?
I think I'm pretty logical. No, I'm not the neatest guy around.
but it does go with a kind of mental discipline?
Right, you have to. I mean, it seems to me in chess, you have to have the talent, but the guys who reach the top are the ones who keep at it. They have the character. They don't get distracted by other things in life until they got the title or whatever they wanted out of chess. You know.
Can you have any other life and be a great chess player?
Not at the moment, no. He's, you know, first things first, right? Get the title. And,
And what's the pleasure? What's the moment of pleasure for you? Is it when you see the guy in trouble? Where's the greatest pleasure? Respond to hitting the home run in baseball.
Oh, the greatest pleasure. Well, when you break his ego, this is where it's at. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
And when does that occur? When he sees that he's finished?
Yeah, you know, he sees it's coming and you know, breaks all up inside. Yeah.
And you like that moment of just crushing the guy.
Right, yeah.
What would you have been if you hadn't? Chess player.
I don't know.
Do you have any idea?
Some kind of sport, something, you know.
It's a sport.
I mean, I haven't gone into it much, but I think I would might have gone for something like that.
Yeah. People expect to, I know when they meet you, they hear a guy who's been a prodigy. You started playing chess when you were what?
Six.
Yeah. Yeah. And they for some reason they expect a frail little fellow with thick glasses, and they're always surprised by the width of your shoulders and the fact that you look like an athlete or swimmer or something like that. Are you good at those things too?
Well, I haven't really, you know, developed myself too much in sports, but I like little swimming, tennis, and just mainly I just use it to keep in shape for the chess.
That sounds funny. Yeah, they laugh to keep in shape for chess, but where does it take strength?
Well, you're sitting there for 5 hours, and
how do you develop that part of your body?
Oh, I mean, you know,
another way
that's
to put
strong,
it
the neck bone is connecting all that stuff. You know,
yeah.
You got to have the blood coming into your head, and the reason that players fade out, say in their 40s or 50s, is because about the fourth or fifth hour of play, they lose their concentration, their stamina is gone. You got a lot of stamina.
Yeah, people do laugh at that, but it takes a terrific amount of stamina, I'm told. Another silly way to ask the question was, a baseball player's legs go, what goes first on a chess player? But I suppose there's no... you do sit an awfully long time. Now, could be part of a strategy? Would a guy take extra time in a match that isn't time just to wear you out physically?
Well, you got the clocks, you know. You can't take too much time because you'll overstep and get forfeited. But you can sort of pace your time to not to move too rapid, not to move too slowly, kind of just wear them down, you know, grind them down.
So it's not just the knowledge of what you do on the board, but a little psychological warfare, too.
Right.
Now, when you used to walk out of matches, what were the reasons for that?
First of all, I only dropped out of 2 matches in my whole life, and I just looked it up, the record. I played in about 60 matches my whole life, so it's been a little exaggerated. Mm-hmm. But I was complaining about the lights, the spectators were bothering me, a lot of noise. You know, they were using all kind of horrible lighting, chandelier-type lighting, when actually you need really soft lighting. This is a serious business, 5 hours. working with your eyes, you know.
Where, because of the glare or the light shining into your eyes?
Yeah, the light shining into your eyes.
Mm-hmm. So. Can you wear a green...
People suggested that to me. They told me I should just, you know, go to any department store. So I went to a few, and none of them had it. So. Mm-hmm.
You honestly think that you probably are the world's greatest chess player. I mean, there's no reason to be modest about it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Well, there's no way that I could disprove that. Did you feel like a prodigy as a kid? You know, did other kids say, oh, he's in playing chess while we're out playing baseball?
No, not too much, no. Yeah.
But you were a prodigy.
I was a prodigy, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that was Bobby Fischer on the Dick Cavett Show in the summer of 1971, a year before he became world champion. Now, about seven years before Fischer made his first appearance on the Dick Cavett Show, he made a special appearance in Fitchburg. He came to Fitchburg, Massachusetts, and that was 1 week before his 21st birthday. That was March 2nd, 1964. He came and did a simultaneous exhibition at the First Parish Universalist Unitarian Church at the Upper Common in Fitchburg, and he took on 56 challengers. And he expected to play only 50, but the place was packed. It was standing room only. He agreed to play additional players, six additional players at no additional interest or revenue to him. You know what he charged for a board fee back in 1964?
No.
$5.
Wow.
To pay Bobby Fischer $5 a board. All he wanted was $250. He was happy. He spent Sunday night, March 1st, here, with one of our club members, Fred Lawrence was his name, mm-hmm. who was an insurance agent with the Prudential Insurance Company, and he put him up for two nights. You know what actually Fischer did on the afternoon of the exhibition?
No.
He was brought down to the Fitchburg Theater and went into the theater and watched the world heavyweight boxing match between then Cassius Clay, known as Cassius Clay, and Sonny Liston,
oh, really?
which had been done less than a week before. They were showing at the Fitchburg Theater. Fischer sat in that theater, Fitchburg Theater, and saw the fight, you know, locally. Anyways, we have some photos from that exhibition that Fischer did in March 2nd, 1964. Darren can show some of these photos. This is actually Fischer, a color photo. Fischer. He's actually standing in front. That's a good view. But the person in the foreground, you see that person with the crew cut? Yep. That's Dick McMaster, a longtime Wachusett Chess Club member. And to his left, we'll get a better picture of who Fischer's making a move against. Let's go to the next photo. Okay, here's a picture of a black and white photo. And I believe he is playing against, yes. You see the person with the glasses?
Yeah.
He's not making a move against him, but that is Lester Garbutz, the fellow who will appear in the red sweater. Mm-hmm. Lester Garbutz was the Wachusett Chess Club champion in 1965, a Fitchburg native, and Fischer was one of the ones he played. Let's go another photo. Okay, here we have Fischer moving against Lester Garbutz. We only have Lester's back, but he's in a red sweater. Mm-hmm. And again, this was played at the First Parish Church at the Upper Common. Again, he did lose five games. He beat 49 players, mm-hmm. drew two, and lost five. One of the five he lost to, we did a program on Harold Dondas,
right.
The longtime Boston Globe chess columnist. Now here's a photo of he's actually playing. Oh, is a fellow with a cigarette. You see the fellow with the glasses, the third person in the row? That is J. Camille LeBlanc, known as J.C. LeBlanc, longtime Wachusett Chess Club member, whose son, Dennis LeBlanc, was a track star at Fitchburg High. Mm-hmm. He was a cross-country. His son was Dennis LeBlanc. That's J.C. LeBlanc, who was a longtime member of the Wachusett Chess Club. Again, so these are some of the photos. And these were taken, by the way, you told me, or I learned, that the Paul Godin, who was our 1967 club champion, took these photos.
Yeah, and our webmaster.
And our webmaster, yep. Right, exactly. So, now, Let us now talk about Fischer. Let me talk about that simultaneous exhibition. Mm-hmm. I tell you that he stayed. Well, here's what happened. Fred Lawrence and Ed Wheeler. Ed Wheeler was another longtime Wachusett Chess Club member. They drove down to Westerly, Rhode Island, late Sunday afternoon on March 1st. That's where Fischer had given a exhibition that afternoon.
Okay.
They picked him up. I mean, well, I just picked up physically, but they